Every year we get a million and one new superhero properties, and most of them are just okay. Rising above the sea of mediocrity, the best superhero shows are the ones that, despite the larger-than-life encounters, reveal uncomfortable truths about the world around us. Invincible easily joins the likes of The Boys and Watchmen in the hall of great subversive superhero stories. While the latter two properties make social commentary an integral part of the story, Invincible opts for a more personal, character-driven drama. But that doesn't mean it can't help us understand our world a little bit better. So if you haven't caught on to how we do it in this channel yet, spoilers for the entire first season. The show follows Mark Grayson, or superhero son to the Superman knockoff Omni-Man, an alien visitor from the planet Viltrum. While initially, Omni-Man paints his homeworld as a futuristic utopia, in the final episode he reveals the brutal truth behind his home planet. At some point, the Viltrumites decided that to further develop their species, they would rid themselves of the weak, leading to a Hunger Games-style purge. After massacring 50% of their population, they ascended into godlike beings, capable of single-handedly destroying planets. And in Omni-Man's own words, they became the perfect civilization. They then turned their power outward, first conquering their galaxy, then sending lone Viltrumites to distant planets to expand the Viltrum Empire. Unfortunately for us, Omni-Man is tasked with conquering Earth. In an effort to convince his son to join him, Omni-Man argues with him.
But we can help them. We can stop wars, eliminate hunger, give them medical technology centuries ahead of what they have now.
Despite this, Invincible is a hopelessly optimistic human at heart. Even when he's beaten into a mushy pulp, he still believes his dad is good, and it's ultimately what persuades Omni-Man to abandon the mission. This is a common trope in sci-fi, where humanity's tendency for good is what sets them apart from other sentient species. If only Omni-Man did a little more exploring, he'd see we have a lot more in common than meets the eye. In the real world, colonization has historically had two motivators, the material and the ideological. The material aspect of colonization is easy to see. Back in the olden days, colonization was seen as an easy way to extract wealth. Nations with a stronger military could dominate smaller ones, and the plundering of natural resources and the new trade networks it created would more than make up for any losses. This was especially true if things weren't going too well at home. It's no coincidence that the Viltrum imperialist project started after they lost half of their population. After what was essentially a massive civil war, conquering other planets amounts to a quick economic stimulus. On the other side of the equation, you have the ideological motivation, which can be just as powerful. Whether you're fighting a religious war or a war for democracy, ideology is present in every colonial project, and Omni-Man's got a heaping load of it. His justification to Invincible is that under Viltrum's rule, they can help humanity, which if you ever paid attention in history class, should sound very, very familiar. Modernization theory is the explanation used to explain how societies transition from pre-modern to modern societies. There's a bunch of factors used when determining how modernization occurs, and proponents of the theory believe that modernization is ultimately a positive force for the world. As society progresses, you see the development of democracy, new technologies and infrastructure, and the abandonment of traditional lifestyles. And here's the important bit. Modernization theory holds that modern countries can help pre-modern countries advance in the stages of modernization by providing aid, support, and sometimes by providing stewardship. Omni-Man's speech to Invincible is the exact same justification Europeans used to justify their conquest 500 years ago. When the Spanish claimed sovereignty over the Americas, they wanted to both evangelize them and to usher the quote-unquote backwards indigenous people into civilization. The British, similarly, viewed the Irish as inferior and incapable of sovereignty. In order to be made free, Ireland had to be under their rule. While ultimately both groups ended up under foreign subjugation, development was used as a positive justification. Here, Omni-Man is no different than a Spanish crusader, only instead of being a religious zealot, he's a secular believer in modernization. And not only is he a modernist, he's also a proponent of really hardcore eugenics. In the real world, modernization and eugenics have been inseparably linked. In the 1800s, as urbanization took hold of city centers like Britain, with peasants moving to the city for work, the middle and upper classes were confronted with a new reality. A permanent underclass was created that they saw as dirty beggars, swindlers, and hookers. This clash between classes led to the creation of an organized eugenics movement that sought to save the nation from degeneration. While eugenics has been practiced in one form or another throughout history, the eugenics we know today is a byproduct of this era of history, and it seems like Viltrum underwent a similar transformation in their society, not to save themselves from degeneration, but to proactively build a superior race of beings using eugenicist logic. Eugenics and colonialism make up the core of Viltrum's representation in the show. And the show does little to provide an opposing viewpoint to Omni-Man. This is probably because his ways are so obviously and horrifically brutal that no sane person could agree. You can't convince a Belgian person today that colonialism was good by showing them the violence of the 20th century Belgian Congo, which is essentially what Omni-Man is trying to do to Invincible. That's why he's so terrifying. He's a superpowered mirror to our own past, a vision of what humanity is capable of if won over by their more evil instincts. But what if Omni-Man had arrived 100, 200 years ago? It would have been a really different story. I'm sure Han Grayson would have loved to do space imperialism with his dad, Omni-Mensch. This is why the implication that it's Invincible's humanity that saves the day doesn't really work for me. It's not so much his humanity, but his 21st century view of colonialism and eugenics. After World War II, colonialism largely faded away as colonizing nations found it was too costly after the growth of the anti-colonial movement in the global south. Eugenics, similarly, went out of style in the upper classes of Europe, mostly. Mark Grayson's perspective comes from decades of historical progress on the issue, but it also reflects a bit of his naive, sheltered perspective on the world. Because colonialism hasn't exactly gone away? The world systems theory is the most widely accepted alternative to modernization theory. It argues that labels like modern and pre-modern are constructs used to justify systems of dependence among nations. In the case of colonization, the exploitative nature of the relationship is easy to see, but some relationships are harder to figure out than others. Say a loan from the International Monetary Fund given to a small country in exchange for the removal of trade protections, or a trade agreement among nations that sees uneven development among the participants. Under world systems theory, this is really just colonialism under a new name, neo-colonialism. The developed nation is still profiting off the labor and wealth of the poorer nation, it's just that now they're using free trade agreements and not weapons. At least not directly. This arrangement keeps nations in the core and the periphery at an uneven pace of development. Under this lens, modernization isn't about progress. Instead, it's about westernization and cultural imperialism. Historically, modernization has involved the genocide of indigenous people and indigenous ways of life, as colonizers superimposed their own culture onto that of the colonized people. The very idea of calling some societies modern and others pre-modern reveals a bit of bias, doesn't it? As all societies are modern if they exist today. The show makes a point out of showing how Invincible is a bit naive. He lives a sheltered middle-class life in the American suburbs, and it's because he's so naive that the twist at the end works really well. In the first episode of the series, we see Omni-Man talking with his son and telling him the sanitized version of Viltrum's story.
When our people come of age, we leave Viltrum and venture out into the galaxy, using our abilities to help lesser developed worlds.
And, like the young Mark Grayson, I think most viewers will be naive enough to believe this fairy tale version of the story. The show plays into our preconceived biases, not only of older superhero stories like that of Superman, but also our general belief in modernization theory that makes us so willing to believe this type of story. But if world systems theory is to be believed, that story, just like Omni-Man's, is just that, a story. Moving on from the Viltrum colonial project, we have another bit of politics inserted into episode 5, which sees Invincible getting roped into helping Titan take on his mob boss, Machine Head. Machine Head rules the criminal underworld of the city, and after Titan has paid off his debts to the villain, Machine Head breaks his promise to him and forces Titan to continue working under him. Titan enlists the help of the main hero, guilt-tripping him in the process.
I called you here because I need your help.
Why would I help you? You're a criminal.
You don't even know what that word means. I'm not a criminal. I just owed one money and now I can't get out.
Who's your boss?
Machine Head.
That's not a real name.
Of course you haven't heard of him. You're a rich kid from the suburbs.
What? No? You don't know.
And the two get their asses beat, and despite Invincible taking his second worst beating in the show, they still manage to get Machine Head arrested. Once the chips are down, Titan's true plan of taking over the organization himself is revealed. Despite double-crossing the hero, Titan never lies to Invincible. He is poor, and he is evidently doing this for his family. And the contradiction he points out to Invincible about their different standards of living echoes the theme of colonization throughout the show. The theory of internal colonialism or uneven development, but internal colonialism sounds cooler, so I'll stick with that. This theory explores the ways the logic of colonialism is expressed within regions. Even in an imperial nation, there exists political and economic inequalities. While the story of Viltrum echoes the massive, earth-trotting colonial projects of centuries past, the inequality between Invincible's and Titan's life reveals how society in this world can create cores and peripheries, colonizers and colonized, within a nation. While the specifics of internal and external colonization differ, they fundamentally serve the same function of dispossessing certain groups of wealth, extracting it, and sending it to the core. Since the 1990s, the internal colonialism theory has fallen out of favor. Depending on who you ask, it's either still a legit theory to understand our world today, or just a really good analogy. But it is noteworthy that in a show that doesn't get too political, the two salient political messages it tries to get across are about imperialist expansion and domestic inequality. And whether the show's writers understood it or not, I don't think that's a coincidence. Anyway, that's all I got for today's video. What do you think? Let me know in the comments down below. Much like the era of modernization, the Bracero program was an economic agreement between unequal partners. And instead of bolstering both economies, it made Mexico and Mexican workers even more reliant on the United States. Bracero.